Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. On this occasion, it is education and skills. I would remind members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press their request to speak buttons during the relevant questions. I can advise the Chamber there is an enormous amount of interest in supplementaries. If I'm to get them in, and I will try, those supplementaries will need to be brief, no long preamble, no five questions masquerading as one question. And ministers, if I could invite brevity as far as possible in the responses, I'd be much obliged. With that, we have question number one, Colin Smith, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for what reason there has been a delay in announcing the projects that will form phase three of the Learning Estate Investment Programme.
Cabinet Secretary.
I understand that local authorities are keen to get clarity on phase three of the Learning Estate Investment Programme. Back in March, the Scottish Government wrote to all local councils to explain that consideration was still ongoing about the projects that would form phase three. This set out the further time that was needed to consider the scope of phase three, including the need to take account of the impact of market volatility on current projects. However, I am committed to announcing the successful projects by June. The Learning Estate Investment Programme follows on from the successful £1.8 billion Scotland Schools for the Future programme, which delivered 117 new or refurbished schools across Scotland.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I don't think I heard an explanation for the delays. The Scottish Government told Parliament on the 22nd of December 2021 that the projects that will form phase three will be announced within 12 months, and 16 months on, we're no further forward. So I hope this time the Government will stick to its new timetable, because the consequence of those delays are that projects such as the Dumfries Learning Town have been put on hold, and the overall cost of projects will be higher due to these delays. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us if the Government will ensure that there will be additional funding to take account of the construction inflation, including to cover the Council's share of those costs caused by the Government's delays, so that no project loses out as a result of those delays?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I did give an outline in my initial response in relation to the delay and that related to market volatility. The member will also appreciate that we have had a change in Cabinet Secretary, and therefore there has been a pause in that respect. But I am absolutely committed to bringing forward the programme in time for that June deadline that I set out. I think it is worthwhile recognising that the latest school estate statistics show that a record number of our schools are now in good or satisfactory condition. The proportion of schools in good or satisfactory condition has increased from 61% back in April 2007 to just over 90% in April of last year. So certainly welcome news. There's more we can be doing. I recognise the member's interest in this, and I look forward to giving him an update in the coming weeks.
I'm brief supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Just to show that recent analysis has shown that between 2015 and 2022, the cost of construction materials, including cement, timber and steel, increased by 60%. So can the Cabinet Secretary outline the pressures that this brings on delivering projects like these new schools, and how the Scottish Government is tackling that?
And briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
There has been, as we have heard, I think, at First Minister's questions today, a period of particular market volatility, which is impacting a lot of infrastructure projects. I know that from my previous experience as Transport Minister. Between 2015 and 2022, material, labour and overall project costs have steadily increased. We need to be mindful of that pressure and recognise what that brings to some of our projects. But I absolutely commit to the Chamber to bringing back an update in relation to the LEAP programme, because I know how vitally important it is to invest in our school estate.
Thank you. Question two, Neil Bibby, who again joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met West College Scotland and what issues were discussed.
Minister Graham Day.
Thank you. The Scottish Government most recent engagement with West College Scotland was last week on Tuesday, 18th April. My officials met with members of the senior management team as part of a programme of active engagement on the interim purpose and principles for post-school education, research and skills that were published last December. The discussion focused on the college's reflections on the interim purpose and principles.
Neil Bibby.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Recent months have been particularly tough for Inverclyde, with job losses at Amazon. Meanwhile, West College Scotland's Finnett Street campus in Greenock has expired and urgently needs replace, but plans for a new campus keep getting kicked down the road. Does the Minister accept the need for a new college campus in Inverclyde, and will the Minister meet with me to discuss this issue, as well as to support the existing estate to ensure it remains fit for purpose and compatible with net zero targets?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, there has been an increase in the government's capital funding for colleges this financial year. But I do recognise the challenge faced by colleges, not only around maintenance, but in relation to upgrading and replacing buildings. In relation to the West of Scotland College, I'm aware of issues with the Oxshall building in Paisley, where I understand the SFC's provided support of £500,000 towards a temporary rewiring solution. I also know, as Mr Bibby's alluded to, the SFC has provided financial assistance to the college to update the outline business case in relation to improving the situation at Greenock. And if an opportunity arises to meet with the college in due course, I'll be happy to accept that and discuss whatever matters they might wish to.
And briefly, Marie McNair.
Thank you, President Officer. This SNP-led Scottish Government is providing our further education students with record levels of support, £141 million in 2021, up 54% in real terms since 2006-07. Can the Cabinet Secretary detail how this investment in the future of our young people is benefiting students such as those at West College Scotland?
I'm briefly...
Our investment continues to make a real difference to the lives of young people across Scotland by helping them to continue in their studies. West College Scotland is one of our largest colleges with over 20,000 students and provides valuable opportunities for those furthest from the workplace. They're doing really good work, and I'm delighted that we've been able to continue the level of funding for student support in this coming financial year.
Thank you. Question number three, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it can provide an update on what progress has been made on its commitment to pilot access to universal free school meals in secondary schools.
Cabinet Secretary.
All primary school pupils in primaries 1 to 5, children in funded early learning and childcare, and eligible pupils in primary 6 through to S6 can already benefit from free school meals in Scotland, the most generous provision anywhere in the UK, and saving parents on average £400 per eligible child per year. But we will need to go further. Our additional investment announced on the 15th of December will continue to fund the expansion of free school meals for all primary 6 and 7 pupils in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment. We remain committed to delivering a pilot of universal free school meals in secondary schools and continue to work closely with key delivery partners on our free school meal expansion programme. I've asked for further advice from officials once that planning work has further progressed, and I'll be happy to provide an update at that point to the Member and the Chamber.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, and I welcome the Cabinet Secretary to her new role. The Scottish Government's commitment to expanding access to universal free school meals is very welcome, and it's shared by the whole Parliament. Can the Cabinet Secretary give an indication of how many secondary schools will be involved in the pilot schemes, and when she expects they will start? What progress has been made on the P67 rollout, given that we've got 90,000 children in Scotland in receipt of emergency food parcels in the last year?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the Member for her question and her interest in this issue. She will know it's a subject very close to my heart, as I know it is hers. In relation to the specifics on her question with regard to the free school meal pilot in secondary schools, as I mentioned, I think in my initial answer, the detail of that is still being considered by officials. I'm more than happy to provide the Member with an update on that. Additionally, if the Member has suggestions for how that pilot might be carried out, I'd be more than happy to see it. And to her further point in relation to the wider rollout on primary 6 and 7, I'm more than happy to give her further updates on that. It's really important we get the rollout of this next phase right for Scotland's children and young people, and I think we should be all working in a spirit of cross-party consensus on this, given the importance to our education system.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Cabinet Secretary noted, Scotland does have the most generous provision of free school meals in the UK, and £400 per eligible child is a very notable amount. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what difference does free school meals make to the educational journey of our young people in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think, as the Member outlined, and as I think I alluded to in my response to Ms Lennon, the policy is really vital in relation to the life chances of our children and young people, particularly given the ongoing impacts of the cost of living crisis, where many families are struggling with the cost of food. We know that school can play a key role in alleviating that burden, and there's also evidence which suggests that the provision of free school meals can help to close the poverty-related attainment gap, can help to raise attainment, and also to improve school attendance. And as I mentioned in my response to Ms Lennon, there is cross-party support for this policy, and it's important that we continue to work together on that expansion.
And briefly, Stephen Kerr.
I welcome the ministers to their new positions. We need to understand why the number of pupils taking school meals is at the lowest point for 10 years, and why on Census Day last year, 60,000 fewer pupils had a school meal than in 2016. So I've had people that work in the school meal service and teachers tell me their concerns about how appetising the meals are, and the lack of investment in facilities. What will the Cabinet Secretary do to increase the take-up rate for school meals?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think he raises a valid point. I know from my experiences in the classroom there can often be a stigma associated with free school meals. It's really important that local authority and government work closely together on this. I'm more than happy to work with the member on this. Additionally, we need to increase uptake and we also need to ensure that there is nutritional value to the meals that are being provided.
Question 4, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support the higher education sector.
Minister Graham.
Now, so the 23-24 budget allocated nearly £2 billion to Scotland's universities and colleges through the Funding Council, demonstrating our commitment to supporting our learners and institutions. I welcome the recent publication by the SFC of the indicative core funding allocations for 23-24, which maintained funding levels in teaching and research despite the challenging fiscal environment. This will enable colleges and universities to move forward with their planning for the year ahead. We've kept our investment in excellent university research at current levels while increasing our investment in university innovation.
Michael Mara.
The Minister must be concerned to hear the reaction of Professor Dame Sally Mapstone to the figures that he lays out, raising concerns that this government's approach to higher education represents, and I quote, managed decline. Yet with a flat cash budget for universities, loosely termed transformation funding, failure to invest adequately in research excellence grant, under this government, managed decline is what we are seeing. Can the Minister define today what the £20 million of transition funding will be spent on, and what will this minister do differently from his predecessor to arrest that managed decline?
Minister.
As Mr Mara is well aware,
Mr Mara, please.
Presiding officer, Mr Mara is well aware, we are in an extremely challenging environment financially, and we're working very closely to deliver the funding that the universities require set against a very, very difficult financial backdrop. He knows that himself. We continue to spend nearly £2 billion a year on Scotland's universities and colleges through the SFC alone, despite the financial pressures faced by government. And we remain committed to the long-term success of universities and colleges, as we've demonstrated with the increase in research and innovation funding. But I recognise, he and I will disagree on this, but the flat cash settlement he refers to in the indicative allocations was against the economic backdrop, as fair as it was achievable, but of course it sets challenges for our colleges and universities. And that's why I will, over the coming weeks and months, be engaging both with the representative bodies and the individual institutions. I met Sally Mapstone last week, and listen to any ideas they have for flexibilities and innovative approaches, which can help them better meet the financial and practical challenges that are confronting them.
Thank you. I've got a number of supplementaries. I want to get through all of them, but they will have to be brief, as will the responses. First, John Mason.
Thank you. Would the Minister agree that both our students and our universities and colleges have benefited from exchanges within Europe, both our students going there and top students coming here? And is it not ironic that Labour supports barriers between us and Europe?
Minister.
Since Brexit, EU students have become ineligible for funding, and as a result, there was a reduction of 64% in the number of students from Europe choosing to study at Scottish universities. And this reduction has undoubtedly impacted our universities. The Scottish Government welcomes the contribution that European and other international students make to our higher education sector, as well as our society, our culture and our economy. They add diversity. Any proposals from the UK Government to further restrict visa requirements for European and other international students would be deeply damaging to our world-class university sector.
And Sue Webber.
Thank you, and I also welcome the Minister to his new position. I met Edinburgh College last week, and they told me that they are faced with extremely difficult budgetary decisions. They tell me that they will not receive any funding for pay rises above 2%, and that every 1% over that will cost them £500,000. I know the Minister shares my concerns for Edinburgh College and other colleges facing similar situations, and given the critical role colleges play in tackling attainment and supporting our economy, can the Minister provide detail about the steps he is taking to ensure colleges are fairly funded?
Free Minister.
The temptation to make a political point here about the impact in the budget of the Scottish Government as a consequence of the economic incompetence of Westminster, and I have way too much respect for Sue Webber to go there. I've just highlighted to Michael Mara, I'm going to, over the next few weeks and months, be engaging directly with the colleges and universities. The financial position is extremely serious. We have the consequences of that, and so do they. But I'll be engaging directly with them and listening to any innovative ideas, things that we can do differently to support them cope with some of the financials and more practical pressures that they're facing.
Briefly, Willie Rennie.
I hear grumbling on the SNP benches about the marriage decline. That's the words of Sally Mapstone, and she knows what she's talking about, leading one of the best universities in Scotland. But the decline is no clearer than if you look at the research performance. We used to get 15% of the UK Research Council funding. It's now down to 12.5%. What is the Minister going to do to reverse that decline?
Minister.
What I'm going to do is behave more constructively than Willie Rennie just did by engaging with the sector. I've met Sally Mapstone last week, and I will be in listening mode as I go around the universities and colleges, genuinely prepared to listen to any ideas they have to help address any of the challenges that they face.
And briefly, Pam Gosse.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There has been cash cuts to the research funding of seven of Scotland's universities in 2023 to 2024, all of whom deliver world-leading research. Does the Minister find this to be consistent with the SNP Government's stated priority to boost research and innovation as set out in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation?
And as briefly as possible, Minister.
Yeah, Presiding Officer, I'm not cited on the specifics of individual universities' allocations, so with respect, I'm not going to go there. I'll tell you what it is consistent with, the financial position, the challenges that we've been set by your government in Westminster because of the economic vandals, sorry, Presiding Officer, the Conservative government in Westminster because of the economic incompetence of Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng.
Question 5, Mark Roscoe.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it can provide an update on what progress it has made towards delivering the Bute House Agreement commitment to ensure that every child has access to mental health and wellbeing support, including counselling services in primary school.
Cabinet Secretary.
We continue to support local authorities with £60 million a year to ensure that every secondary school has access to counselling services, which are now in place across Scotland. Authorities provide 6 monthly reports on the services. Over 14,500 pupils accessed the service between January and June of last year, and over 6,000 of those reported improved outcomes, with the majority of the remaining young people still accessing the service and therefore outcomes not yet captured. But it's also important to say that school counselling is just one of a range of services that schools have in place to support pupils' wellbeing.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response and welcome her to her new post? We'll look forward to working with her constructively. It is, of course, critical that every child and young person has access to that support. As the Cabinet Secretary has already said, councils have been required to share 6 monthly reports on access to counsellors in secondary schools and community-based services. And I think what these reports show is that the efforts to increase the access to counsellors in high schools are really succeeding. But we do lack the equivalent data for primary schools. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what consideration the Government has made of expanding the requirement for councils to produce those 6 monthly reports to primary schools as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Ruskell for his supplementary question. Again, I look forward to working with him. We worked closely in my last ministerial post, and I hope that can continue. I very much agree that all children and young people should have access to mental health and wellbeing support in schools. We all know the impacts of COVID on our school system and the ongoing impacts, I have to say, that continue to be played out in our classrooms across the country. We need to be mindful of that and provide that provision of support. The 6 monthly reports the member alludes to on community mental health services and school counselling, I am advised, do include data on primary school aged children. So the returns from authorities in relation to school counselling services include that breakdown of children and young people accessing the service per year group. And of course, between January and June of 2021, 1,300 children in primary schools accessed the school counselling service, over 1,800 between July and December of 2021, and over 3,000 between January and June of last year. I hope that helps to give the member some level of reassurance in relation to the 6 monthly reporting.
Again, there's a number of supplementaries. We'll try and get through all of them, but they will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Although it is essential to ensure that good mental health services are available in our education system, I'm not sure that the increasing need for these services is the only aspect of this crisis. Surely we need to divert resource and attention to preventing poor mental health. And does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that mental health and physical health are related? And if she does agree with that, with me, that the education system from preschool onwards is the ideal battleground to introduce physical activity as a way of combating the rising need for mental health services?
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much recognise Brian Whittle's interest in this. Brian Whittle and I were elected at the same time, and I have recounted a number of occasions where he has raised this issue in the Chamber in the interim years. I recognise the connection between physical activity and good mental health very much so in my own life, actually, and I think we need to extend that understanding to young people as well. The school curriculum in Scotland is built, of course, in the 4 capacities, and there is a capacity within that context, which looks at providing better mental health, of course, and supporting that through physical activity is vital. So PE teachers in our secondary schools are fundamental, but in our primary sector, our teachers have a key role to play in that endeavour as well. We will continue to provide that additionality in relation to the support for counsellors in our schools. I was in the Royal High School not far from the Parliament last week, where I previously taught, listening to some of the impact that that school counsellor has in that school community. But the member is right, it's not just about school counsellors in our school, it's about that broader approach to support throughout the school community.
And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Another commitment made in the Bute House Agreement was to raise awareness and understanding of mental health issues in schools and colleges, but the NUS, Colleges Scotland and University Scotland have said that student councils across Scotland are facing imminent redundancy due to funding ambiguity beyond this academic year. So will the Cabinet Secretary commit to providing absolute clarity to the higher education sector today on funding for student councillors to prevent those redundancies and reassure students that they can access the mental health support that they need?
I thank the member for his question. We have confirmed a further £2 million in this academic year to March of this year, and the SFC has now published guidance on this. We remain very much committed to funding for the entirety of the current academic year to an amount broadly in line with what was provided in 21-22, and we've confirmed that to the sector. Now, final allocations, the member will understand, will be confirmed through the Scottish Funding Council shortly, but I do want to put on the record very much so my support for that commitment. It's really important we continue to support good mental health across our education system.
Briefly, Beatrice Wishart.
Recruitment of healthcare professionals in rural and island areas continues to be a challenge, so what measures can be taken to clear down waiting lists for mental health treatment to ensure that counselling services in these rural and island primary schools are provided?
Cabinet Secretary.
In relation to, I'm not necessarily sure if the member is discussing the issue of CAMHS waiting lists. If that is the point the member is making, I'm more than happy to give her an update on that. We have seen, I think it's important to reflect the number of children starting treatment from CAMHS in the most recent quarter, comfortably one of the highest figures on record. Now, the last four quarters have seen each of the four highest figures on record for the number of children starting treatment from CAMHS, which is good. There is more we will need to do. As I mentioned, I think, in my response to Mr Kerr, I am very cognisant of the impact of the pandemic ongoing as it is on the young people who lived through that, who were out of formal education for a number of years. There is more we will need to do working in local communities to help support that provision of support in relation to good mental health.
Question six, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its work to keep the promise to those who are care experienced.
Minister Natalie Dawn.
The Scottish Government is strongly committed to keeping the promise, and I am delighted to have the opportunity to lead this work through this new ministerial post. I am heartened by the cross-party commitment across the Parliament to introduce the change required to ensure our children and young people feel loved, feel that they are safe and that they are respected. Since coming into post, I have received correspondence from a range of partners, and I am excited to have the opportunity to see for myself the great work underway across Scotland in the coming weeks and months. The Scottish Government published its Promise Implementation Plan last March, and we continue to build change within our education, health and justice agendas.
Colette Stevenson.
I thank the Minister for that response and I welcome her to her new role. Can the Minister outline the continued engagement the Scottish Government is having with children and young people who are in the care system, as well as those who are care experienced, and can she also confirm the steps the Scottish Government is taking to ensure young people have the support of scaffolding to lead independent lives as young adults?
Minister.
Thank the member for that question. So the previous First Minister and the Minister for Children and Young People met regularly with members of the care experience community, and I am delighted by the opportunity to carry this engagement on. The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring that in developing the policy and legislative change required to keep the promise, it is essential that the voice of the care experience community continues to inform the actions that we take. We continue to work with our partners, including the Promise Scotland, Who Cares Scotland, the Network of Local Champions Boards, and through the Promise Design School to ensure their voice is heard. We know that many young people with experience of care may not have access to the same family networks, support or opportunities as their non-care experienced peers, and providing the right and timely support in the move to independent living is essential. And we are committed to supporting transition through inclusive and accessible support to education, employment, transport and housing. We remain committed to the introduction of a £10 million care leaver payment in this parliamentary term to provide further support to the 50,000 young care experienced people between the ages of 16 and 26.
Very briefly, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and Ministers to their new posts and indeed transferred posts.
With regard to the data that's required, the Data for Children's Collaborative have highlighted a shortfall from the third sector and stakeholders by the use of questionnaires. What is the Minister going to do to address the concern that obtaining quality assurance over information is going to require ongoing resource and work?
As briefly as possible, Minister.
Yes, we understand that the recording of that data is absolutely essential, and that is something that I will be working on. As the member is aware, I'm fairly new to this post, but that is something that I'm happy to come back to him on.
Thank you. Question 7, Miles Brick.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that school buildings remain safe and in good condition.
Cabinet Secretary.
It is the statutory duty of local authorities to manage and maintain their school estate, and we expect them to provide a safe environment for all school users. There are a record number of schools in good or satisfactory condition, and the proportion of schools in those categories has increased from 61% in April 2007 to just over 90% in April of last year. The Scottish Government, in partnership with local councils, are providing significant funding for schools through the £2 billion Learning Estate Investment Programme, which will provide the benefits to tens of thousands of pupils across Scotland.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The danger of toxic asbestos is common knowledge. Despite this, though, over 1,700 schools across Scotland still contain this hazardous material. It is critical that the Scottish Government and councils act quickly as possible to remove the asbestos from the Scottish school estate to ensure that pupils, teachers and staff across Scotland are learning and working in a safe environment. So can I ask, what progress has the Scottish Government made in removing asbestos from schools? What impact assessments have been undertaken to look at where currently asbestos is in the school estate and where this will be removed? And what timescale will government develop to make sure this happens?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think he raises a really important point. It is, of course, the case that local authorities have a responsibility for our school buildings, but I recognise, I think, the member's colleague asked an FOI on this very matter very recently, and I've asked officials for additional advice in relation to action that we may be able to take as a government on this issue. It remains ongoing. Obviously, a number of the schools that we're talking about are historically old buildings. I confess the last building I worked in over in Fife had asbestos in it. It's soon to be replaced with a brand new building, thanks to this government. And I think that's hugely important as we move forward in improving the school estate. But we will need to recognise some of the challenge here. The other point to mention is that, of course, health and safety legislation is not devolved to the Scottish Government. The Health and Safety Executive is a UK-wide body, and therefore I've taken advice, I've commissioned advice from officials on what more we might be able to do in this space in relation to school buildings.
A very brief supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
The management of asbestos, it's worth mentioning, is the same right across the UK, and it's vital to note that asbestos should remain in situ while it's in good condition, since it's only dangerous when disturbed. Can the Cabinet Secretary expand on some of the detail of that?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
I think, as I reiterated in my response to Miles Briggs, it is the case, obviously, that the Health and Safety Executive operate at a UK-wide level. I've commissioned advice from officials in relation to further action this government might be able to take in this space.
Thank you. We have a bit of time over the course of the afternoon, so I'm going to go to question number 8, Ros McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the announcement of the Scottish Funding Council's indicative budget allocations for
23-24.
Mr. Graham Day. The Scottish Government very much welcomes the publication of the 23-24 indicative core funding allocations by the Funding Council, which enables colleges and universities to move forward with their planning for the academic year.
Ross McCall.
I thank the Minister for that response. There is a full-blown mental health crisis unfolding in our universities, it's been previously pointed out. Last year, almost every university reported a sharp increase in the number of mental health support requests, with a number of students coming forward almost tripling compared to 10 years ago. It's therefore deeply concerning that the Scottish Funding Council is to cut 80 counsellors whose funding ended earlier this month. Colleges and universities have made it clear that this counselling will not remain in place without this financial support. And as the member was of the Education Committee, the Minister shared my concerns about the impact these cuts will have on students in desperate need of support. So what can he do in his new role, and I welcome him to that, to ensure that this vital support for our young people in our universities continues?
Minister.
President Officer, the member's right. I do have an interest in this matter, not just as a minister, but prior to that. Can I offer her assurance that no such decision has yet been taken? Not least of all because I have a meeting in about an hour and a half's time on this very subject. There are significant financial challenges, as I've alluded to earlier on, but I fully recognise the benefit that the councils have brought to the colleges and university. I was at Queen Margaret University last weekend. I heard firsthand for myself. So I can make no commitment at this stage, but we do recognise the need to provide accessible mental health provision for our students, not only in the universities, but in the colleges as well. And we also have a student mental health plan being developed. So I offer other reassurance, no decision has been taken on that as yet.
A couple of brief supplementaries, but they will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The latest Higher Education student stats show an increase of 31.4% since 2006-07 of Scottish domiciled full-time first-degree entrants at our unis. Can I ask the Minister what link he sees between this increase and the decision to introduce free university education by scrapping graduate endowment, and which party was it that did this?
Briefly, Minister.
Presiding Officer, bearing in mind your instruction at the end of this, there self-evidently is a link, and if memory serves, it was the SNP.
Thank you very much. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, very briefly.
I thank the Minister for the answer to those questions and welcome him to his role. In last year's letter to the Funding Council, the Government said they expected institutions to create fair and equal society through their work as anchor organisations. The Cabinet Secretary and the Minister will be aware of UCU action to boycott marking and assessment as a result of ongoing disputes over paying conditions, with some universities threatening up to 100% deductions on staff wages for those who participate. So can I ask the Minister to confirm whether he considers those pay deductions to meet the expectations of the Government, condemn it as an attack on workers' rights to strike, agree to write to institutions and remind them of their fair work obligations, and finally accept 13 years of cuts?
Ms Duncan-Glancy, Minister.
Minister, President Officer, apologies. Briefly, it is a matter of concern that this dispute has arisen. As recently as last week, I was at Queen Margaret University. I met the lecturers. I also spoke to the principal there and made the point that this needed to be addressed.
Thank you very much. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.